The basketball team seasons heat up.
And the men's swimming and diving team looks to stay unbeaten.
This is All Access, and it starts right now. Welcome to All Access, the show that is not as complicated as NFL kickers trying to make extra points. I'm Cody Decker.
And I'm Nolan Foy. Hope you enjoyed your Thanksgiving, which included a great slate of NFL games. Meanwhile, with our week off, we have 2 weeks worth of recaps to share with you, so let's get started with the men's basketball team. Cody?
Thanks, Nolan. The men's basketball team won a thriller against Farmingdale State College 89-87 in the first round of the Widener University tip-off for Autism Awareness Tournament. Forward Sean Wilson led the way for the Pros with 30 points and 5 rebounds. The Pros led 88-82 with 28 seconds left, but held off a late surge by Farmingdale for the win.
The team would defeat host Widener University to win the tip-off for Autism Awareness Tournament Championship. The Pros pulled away with the 91-87 win. Forward Sean Wilson tallied 30 points for the second straight game in the tournament and shot 50% from the field. Guard Rob DePersia had 16 points and 6 assists to help the Profs earn the victory.
After the tournament, Rowan won another nail-biter, this time against Stockton University by a score of 101-100. Sean Wilson gave the Profs the lead with 38 seconds remaining, a lead that they were able to keep a hold of, despite a late bucket by the Ospreys. Guard Jeff Haddock had a career-high 22 points. 21 of those points came from 7 three-point shots that he made.
The men's basketball team was blown out in an exhibition game against Division I Princeton University last Friday. The Tigers spread the scoring out evenly amongst their roster, handing the Profs a devastating 108-46 loss. The Profs suffered the same fate against the Tigers last year, losing 96-48. Guard Nick DePersia had 13 points and 6 rebounds. Guard Rob DePersia and forward Sean Wilson had 6 points apiece.
Rowan's men's basketball team was able to take home the W on Saturday in the Coaches vs. Cancer Classic against Rosemont College at Gwend Mercy University. The final score of the game was 99-94, with guard Nick DePersia leading the guard charge for the Profs with 26 points and 5 rebounds while shooting 10-for-14 from the floor, including 4 threes. This win advances the men's team to a record of 4-1 on the season.
Back in conference play, the men's basketball team squeaked out a 78-75 win over Rutgers Newark on Wednesday night. Off the bench, guard Jeff Haddock had 20 points, an assist, and a steal, shooting 3 of 6 from long range. Forward Sean Wilson shot 8 of 12 from the field, contributing 18 points and 2 assists. The Profs improved to 5-1 on the season and 2-0 in the NJAC. They will host conference rival William Patterson on Saturday for a 3 p.m. tip-off.
Now for the latest in the world of pro sports, we send it over to Thomas DiNapoli for this week's Pro Talk.
Thanks, Cody. Now to the wacky, crazy, and unbelievable world of professional sports. Starting on the most somber of notes, the Cleveland Browns remain defeated on the season, moving to 0-12. The Browns hosted the New York Giants on Sunday. After an Isaiah Crowell fumble, Eli Manning hooked up with Dwayne Harris for a 13-yard touchdown catch. The Giants added an Odell Beckham touchdown to go up 14-3. The Browns added a field goal, making it 14-6 at the half. The Giants continued to dominate the Browns and capped off their win at 27-13. Giants moved to 8-3, and once again, the Browns remain 0-12 on the season. Tiger Woods is back. Tiger Woods was at the Hero World Challenge, which is an unofficial PGA Tour event hosted by Tiger Woods himself, which is played in the Bahamas with an 18-man field and no cut. The tour sounds kind of fake to many, but to a lot of people, it exists to chart Tiger Woods' process. The last time we saw Tiger was when he hit 3 golf balls into water in a suburban Maryland town. I'll have to wait and see if Tiger's back holds up for his much-anticipated return. On Monday Night Raw, viewers saw the women's title change hands again. That's right, Sasha Banks defeated Charlotte to become the Raw Women's Champion. In what was an excellent match, the booking is still questionable. In the past 3 months, the title has changed 3 times, with Reigns not even lasting a full month. In what is a good rivalry, fans start to question why the WWE is playing hot potato with the belt. With the Royal Rumble around the corner, eyes will be on Sasha and Charlotte to see what happens with their feud and the title. Yoenis Cespedes is back. The Mets and Cespedes inked a four-year, $110 million deal. This is an annual salary of $27.5 million a year, only seen before by Alex Rodriguez. The Mets finally showed faith in their gotta pay him, but the Mets also liked how they did not have to commit to him for more than 4 years. Cespedes has a .282 batting average with the Mets with an on-base percentage of .348, 48 home runs, and 130 RBIs. Not to mention all the clutch moments and the love from the fans. Dare I say it? Let's go Mets. That's all I have for you on this week's Pro Talk. Later, Cody and Chris have more from the basketball court. But after the break, Kevin will sit down with two RTN alumni to discuss the latest in World Wrestling Entertainment. So stay tuned for more All Access.
Welcome back to All Access. Time for this week's SmackDown of a Rowan Roundtable. Joining me are RTN alumni Benny Pinella and Steve Romanchik, who will be talking about some pro wrestling topics. You guys ready?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Awesome. I love the pun to open up the SmackDown of a round. I love that.
Got to make it fun. Got to make it interesting. So we'll start with you, Benny. Recently, the beast that is known as Brock Lesnar suffered a big-time loss at the hands of Goldberg at Survivor Series. After that defeat, what do you think is next for Lesnar? And also, what do you think is next for Goldberg?
Well, it looks like Goldberg's going to go into the Rumble, which I like. Make him look strong. He's going to eliminate a couple of jobbers here and there, hopefully a Sin Cara. I really wanted to see him spear Sin Cara out of the ring. I don't like Sin Cara. As for the decision of the match, I mean, well, Lesnar's also going to the Rumble. As for the decision of the match, people have been saying they're really kind of nervous for what's going to happen. I'd be nervous as well. WWE's taking a risk here. Brock Lesnar is their draw. I mean, when you think about a guy in the WWE right now, people are going to say Undertaker. He's not a regular wrestler. Lesnar's as close to as a draw that's kind of regular you're going to get because no one else on the roster is really a draw. I mean, Jericho, if you're in Canada. But Lesnar's their draw. Lesnar's their guy. Lesnar is the beast incarnate. And then you just had him lose in a minute 26 to Goldberg. It's risky because if they don't do this story correctly, it's going to be bad. I mean, he is the guy that transcends pop culture right now in terms of being in wrestling. People, when you talk about Lesnar at a bar, people know who you're talking about. UFC fans,
right.
Sports fans in general. This is the guy that played defensive tackle for the Vikings, I believe, for a year. Was practice squad, but still. He's dominant in UFC. He's one of the best fighters in his weight class. Can jump between doing the WWE and the UFC. So it's a risk. It looks like they're going Goldberg Lesnar at Mania. I just hope the story's okay.
Right, and as you even mentioned, they might even be facing each other at the Rumble at some point.
Yeah,
Who knows?
Going to be like he's going to come in one, and then you know Lesnar will come in and probably F5 him out.
Absolutely, Steve.
This is a weird thing because when I looked at it, I was on the phone with you when it happened because
we were shocked.
Yeah, because it was one of those things where Survivor Series match happened before, which was an hour long, and then you go to that minute 23, I think that's what you said, and then I told them on the phone, I was like, there's no way this is over. They had 40 minutes left in the show to begin with, but there's no possible way. So I went back and watched it. And the only way I can see it is like he caught him off guard, blah blah blah, like that.
Right.
Honest to God, I thought I was dreaming when it happened.
Yeah.
I thought I had fallen asleep, and then I was like, I've slapped myself, and I was like, wait, that really happened? That wasn't a promo for something. That actually happened.
The whole buildup and everything like that.
Gone.
And the only thing that I thought of was, why was it so short? And the only reason I can come up with, and from what some reports was, that he actually said himself, he hasn't taken a bump yet. He has not taken a bump yet. He is not even, when he was training, he was just doing cardio training. Wasn't even taking, running the ropes, anything like that. So I guess that's what happened. And they're just planning to go to Mania and Rumble, which neither one are going to win the Rumble.
No.
So, yeah.
Yeah, fair point. As you mentioned, the bump in the road, and that might be a big hurdle for him to overcome. Mm-hmm. My next point is about the tag team title match at NXT for the TakeOver in Toronto. What are your expectations, Steve?
That was a phenomenal match. Gargano Ciampa versus The Revival had you on the edge of the seat. I was at Barclays Center for Brooklyn Takeover, which saw the first one of that, and it was so good. And then coming up, we're going to have, I think, San Antonio. We don't know what's going to happen with that yet, if they're going to do another one, but The Revival need to go to the main roster. Gargano Ciampa or DIY needs to stay down for a little bit, and just phenomenal match. Hands down, best match of the night.
Benny? Yeah, we've gotten used to crank some good matches being cranked out in NXT. NXT is just, I mean, if you're a fan of wrestling, you got to watch NXT. It's just another instant classic, another A-plus match, storytelling involved.
Pacing.
Yeah, everything's just great about the revival, and I can't wait for those guys to, like, wrestle at Mania. That'd be great. Mm-hmm. Not this Mania, like, maybe two or three Manias down the road, but, you know, NXT just cranks out one great match after the next. And that's what we saw.
Absolutely. So, we'll go back to you, Benny. The next pay-per-view event is for the WWE's Tables, Ladders, and Chairs, which is coming up on the 4th of December. Just a couple of days away. What match are you most excited to see?
The women's tables match. I believe that's the first.
Damn, that was the one I was going to go with.
That's the first.
I think that's the first one.
One involving the title.
Well, I don't know if they've ever had a women's
it was
match.
Beth Phoenix and
Lay Cool,
whatever the hell that was. this is the first one involving the title, and there's a story to it. I like it. I also like the IC title match in the ladder. I mean, they've had so many great IC title matches on the ladder. They've had Razor Ramon, Shawn Michaels, Rob Van Dam has been in there as well. It's just they crank out one great ladder match with the IC title after the other, and I think this could be a good one. It has story involved, Dolph Ziggler overcoming his demons from his past, The Miz, of course, be feeling unappreciated. Those are probably my match. I can't. If you told me to pick one, I could. Basically, why I am.
I mean, yeah. I mean, that's understandably so. It sounds like a very exciting schedule. Steve?
Because it's the main event, AJ Styles versus Dean Ambrose is a very good match. It's intriguing.
We've seen it before.
Yeah, we've seen it before. The one I'm going to go with is, I'm hoping they win, is Bray Wyatt and Orton versus, Team Beast or whatever they call it.
It's Slater and Ryan.
Slater and Ryan, whatever.
They bounce names
but
off.
But I'm excited because Bray Wyatt might win his first championship in WWE, which is a long time coming. I think he's been in there 3-4 years now. It's just about time he wins something. So I'm excited for that, to see that. But the whole card's good, especially with the lack of buildup because Survivor Series was 2 weeks away. I think it's a very good card.
All right, guys, we got time for one last quick question. I'll go back to you, Steve. All-time favorite wrestling match of all time. Go.
Favorite wrestling match. A lot of people say Taker versus Shawn Michaels at WrestleMania 25 is their best. Mine is about timing, and this was the CM Punk John Cena match at Money in the Bank because of the location of course, it was in Chicago, CM Punk's hometown. The title, which you don't know if it's going to stay or go. Just everything about it was just perfectly timed, and it was just luck. They got lucky, and the match was phenomenal. Everything about it was great. That's my overall favorite match of all time.
Taker versus Michaels at 26. Putting a career on the line there for Michaels. That's just great storytelling. I mean, see, people are going to sit there and say, oh, why do you love wrestling? It's fake. Oh, it's not. I don't watch wrestling because I want to see two guys kick themselves in the face. I don't watch it for chair shots. I don't watch it for any of that. I watch it for stories. That's my entertainment, you know? And when I get a story told like Shawn Michaels' career ending with Taker, that's what I want to see, not Paul Burchill.
Well, thank you guys, but that does it for this Rowan Roundtable. I would like to thank Benny and Steve.
My pleasure.
Pleasure's ours, guys, for taking the time out of your busy schedules to join us. Cody and Nolan, back to you at the desk.
Thanks, Kevin. Time to see how the women's basketball team fared in their latest games. Take it away, Nolan.
Thanks, Cody. The Profs women's basketball team was able to take home a 92-77 victory on last Friday against the College of Mount St. Vincent. Guard Summer Criley scored a career-high 22 points, along with 5 rebounds to lead the way for the Profs. Teammate Anissa Sanchez recorded a double-double as well with 20 points and 16 rebounds.
With an 85-63 victory last Saturday against the Newman Knights, the women's basketball team was able to take home the Newman University tip-off tournament title. Guard Anissa Sanchez for Rowan was voted the most valuable player for the tournament and was joined by teammate and fellow guard Summer Criley on the tournament all-tournament team.
Rowan suffered their first loss this past Tuesday when the team took on Stockton University in an away game. For Stockton, Sasha Williams had a double-double with 20 points and 18 rebounds, and Naja Treadwell also had a double-double with 17 points and 15 rebounds. For the Profs, April Zimczyk and Anissa Sanchez each had 14 points apiece. Despite a late run for the Profs, the final score was 72-68, advancing Stockton to a record of 4-0 this season.
It was the home opener for the Profs women's basketball team as they took on Lehman College. The team was able to put together their largest offensive outburst in 15 years, taking the win with them with a final score of 107-89. Six Profs were able to score double digits in scoring, and the team was led by center April Zimchik, who had 15 points.
The women's basketball team would pick up a convincing second straight victory with an 83-64 win at Rutgers Newark Wednesday night. Guard slash forward Alex Raring shot 8 of 13 from the field, scoring a career-high 20 points off the bench. She also had 4 rebounds and 2 steals. Guard Anissa Sanchez contributed with 15 points, 8 rebounds, 4 assists, and 4 steals. The women are also now 5-1 on the season, but have a 1-1 record in the conference. They will look to improve that NJAC record when they host William Patterson on Saturday at 1 p.m.
After the break, Lenny Schnee will sit down with Thomas DiNapoli for analysis on the D2 ice hockey team. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to All Access. Time for this week's edition of Prof Spotlight. Thomas DiNapoli joins me as we discuss the latest on the Division II ice hockey team, what we can expect now that we're rounding out the semester. Tom, welcome.
Thanks for having me, Leonard. Glad to be here.
This is not a place that you are unfamiliar with, as you were our Prof Spotlight host last semester, so welcome back, I guess, should be the way I'm saying it.
Yeah, not my first rodeo. You know how it goes.
So, Tom, we're talking about Rowan Division II ice hockey. We cover them the most here at RTN. They're 11-5-1 this year, 6-1-1 at home, 5-4 on the road, though, so struggling a little bit on the road. 79 goals, 4-51 against. Coming up this weekend, they have Ryder on Saturday, Wagner on Sunday, and then Penn State the following Friday, which hopefully we will be making the trip to.
Yeah, it's a long ride. We'll see.
We shall see. So let's recap their last couple of games. Montclair last Friday before Thanksgiving, a 6-0 victory for Rowan. Now, you weren't there. I wasn't there. Cody and Kevin did make the trip for RTN, so let's just recap for everybody that's watching the goal scorers. We had Mike Volpio with 1 goal, Sam Meyer with 1 goal, Peter Kaz with 2 goals, Zach Lanning with 1 goal, and Brandon Cacaval with 1 goal. The following night, they hosted Westchester. You were on the mic for that, so Maybe you can elaborate a lot more on that 4-3 shootout victory.
Well, the thing with both of these games, when you look at them, no scoring was scored, if you want to say that, in the first period in both of those games. And it's not just from Rowan's side, it's from the side of both teams, Montclair and Westchester. So that was interesting, and Rowan really came out strong against Montclair. 5 goals in the second, obviously all unanswered. They were able to shut out Montclair. But when you take a look at the Westchester game, they came out and they were up. They were up 2-0, and then Westchester scored 3 unanswered goals. And the weird thing about that game is we've seen Justin Adiello play lights out this season, but during the Westchester game, he didn't. He ended up pulling himself out of the game, then Cody Riley was inserted after he gave up the 3 unanswered goals. Nadiello, that's be giving up the unanswered goals. And I know you said something about this, but Nadiello kind of did the catcher type thing where he reached out with his glove. When in hockey you let it come to you, you're not trying to frame a pitch like you do in baseball. And it hit off his glove and went in the back of the net. And I believe that was Joe Moran's second goal. So that was a weird situation. I think it showed a lot of poise from Nadiello to take himself out of the game in favor of Cody Riley. And Justin, I believe he'll bounce back. And it was a hard game for him. Rowan did win in a shootout. However, the thing is with the rankings period, when you do win in a shootout, it still counts as a tie. A shootout's kind of a nostalgia thing. So for Rowan, it's not the best thing in the world that they couldn't come out and beat Westchester right in even regulation or even in the overtime period.
Yeah, and you just mentioned the rankings. Actually, before this interview, I went to get more specific stats because I actually was the in-studio director for that game, so I didn't exactly watch it maybe in the way that you did. I was more worried about the camera shots and all that good stuff. So I went on the ACHA website, and the score is actually still down as 3-3 because when it goes to ACHA rankings, it stays as a tie, which is unfortunate for Rowan because they have dipped in the rankings the last couple of periods. However, now Rowan sitting at 11-5-1, facing Ryder again on Saturday. Big rival, however, this time the Profs are home. They lost 5-2 on October 7th, but they were at Luke's Ice Center out in Lawrenceville for Ryder. So what do you think is going to go on this game? Maybe different from the last matchup?
What they have to do is they have to watch Christopher Fox for the Ryder Bronx. He, I believe, had 2 goals in the previous game. And they have to take advantage of their home ice. They've been playing so well at home. And We asked Coach about this pretty much every home game, especially when we have RTN coverage where we're on the road one game and then we come back and we're home for another game. It doesn't seem like more often than not, but there's been a couple of times this year where they've lost on the road to maybe a team not as good, and then they beat the better team at home. So they really enjoy Hollydale, so they're going to have to use that to their advantage, because you got to remember, Ryder is a MAC North opponent. So you want to beat somebody who's in the MAC North, especially on top of just always winning at home. So it's going to be a big game for them up against Ryder. And again, second time we will be covering Ryder this year. And again, this may be the one to avenge their loss earlier this season.
Yeah, definitely. Ryder is coming off a huge 4-3 victory over Army, who is having a surprisingly good season, sitting at 9-6. Now, Ryder's goaltender usually is their backbone, C.J. Lyman. He was big last year when it came to the MAC playoffs, which we covered extensively with RTN. He's not having the best year. He's 5-7 with a 4.00 goals against. So clearly the profs, that is something that they need to take advantage of when they're going against linemen on Saturday.
Well, they need to take advantage of that, and they need to take advantage of their depth. If you were, you saw, obviously you read it too, there were five different goal scorers against Montclair when they won 6-0. You know, they have the depth, but the thing is, when their depth doesn't really show, it seems like it's really only Nikolai, Meyer, and McGahee who are scoring. And when just those three score, there's a good chance of winning. But when you get the contributions from your Pete Kazes, your Matt Morellis, your Zach Landigs, your Aaron Signello, Steffi Twins, when you get those deeper line contributions, like said Brandon Cacavalli had a goal against Montclair, when you get those, that's when Rowan really seems more poised to win. Not saying, you know, McGahee and Nikolai are having a great season. Sam Meyer is also having a really good season, and we don't focus on him so much just because of how good Nikolai and McGahee are doing. But it's good to see Sam Meyer and Aaron Signello continue, again, Signello first year in the program, Meyer in his second year, continue to have this good season, but they need to keep it up all the lines, even, again, the lower line. Your Grayson Pettys, your Ryan Trudells, your Christopher McDermott's, like we said, Glandig, your Cacavallis, your Connor McEwen's, they need to have an impact in the game. And when they do, and it's a positive impact, more often than not, Rowan's going to come out victorious.
Yeah, absolutely. You mentioned McGahee. He's scoring a lot. Unfortunately, he's not going to be here next semester, but he will have these final three games to play. The next one after Ryder, Sunday night, the profs head to Prudential Center to play Wagner College. Fortunately, Wagner College not having their best season. They are 0-11 so far. Rowan beat them 5-1 back in October, so this should be an easy W for the profs. Now, to look ahead to Penn State, it's going to be a long bus ride, 4 or 5 hours. It's going to be a late start, 10:15 p.m. Penn State, they're 7-1 so far this year and 2-0 at home. They have an unbelievable 47 goals for and 19 goals against, and the big reason for the goals against, Michael DeGaetano. He's their goaltender. He's a brick wall. Played every game so far this year. Former MAC goaltender of the year. We saw him last year at the MAC tournament. He's unbelievable, and he's their backbone.
Yeah, DeGaetano is fantastic. But before we jump the gun to Penn State with Wagner, that was where Coach Caulfield got thrown out last year, so we'll see if he could contain himself. And it's one of those games where, yes, they should win, but you cannot just go and have that mindset, because if you lose to Wagner and then you go to Penn State, they're not going to be up for it mentally. And maybe for Penn State, you know, no Ryan Urban this year. They still have, you know, Stefan Horgas. And there are some names that are very familiar. But the thing is with Roan, maybe because it is a night game, you know, maybe getting that long night's sleep in your bed and then having the long bus ride, you could really focus on the game rather than having to get on the bus at 10 in the morning and then going to play a game. Maybe the 10:15 start time will be good for Roan. Maybe it'll get them time to really shake off their bus legs, have a good night's sleep, and go out and hopefully beat Penn State, something they have a hard time doing at home. Maybe they can do it on the road.
So more of a glass half full kind of look at the long bus ride.
Of course.
I like the way you think, Thomas. Don't forget that you can catch all those hockey games livestream.com/RTNTH5/RTN Sports. And unfortunately, that does do it for this week's edition of Prof Spotlight. Make sure you check out all the Roiland Ice Hockey all season long, like I just said, on RTN Channel 5. Cody and Nolan, back to you.
Thanks, Lenny. Time to start our final segment with a recap of Rowan's lone runner in the men's cross-country national championship meet. Cody?
Thanks, Noel. Kevin Veltri competed at the NCAA Division III Championships on November 19th. He finished in 161st place out of 278 runners in the 8K race with a time of 25 minutes, 46.4 seconds. Beltre was one of seven individual qualifiers from the Atlantic Regionals, finishing 13th in that meet. He also finished and earned him an all-region honors, and it was a team best time of 24 minutes, 50 seconds. We congratulate Kevin on his accomplishments this season.
Men's swimming and diving defeated Pace University 140-76. The 200 medley and freestyle team stole the show once again by bringing home wins. Paul Long won the 200 freestyle and Mike Simonek won the 200 individual medley, leading the profs to an undefeated 5-0 start.
The Rowan women's swimming and diving team also picked up a victory against Pace University 144-93. The 200 medley and freestyle relay teams took first place. Emily Lebensky won the 200 IM with a time of 2 minutes, 16.96 seconds, and the 200 butterfly with a time of 2 minutes, 21.49 seconds. Bailey Howarth also won two events, the 500 freestyle and the 200 breaststroke. The team improved to 3-2 on the season and will compete in the WPI Gompei Invitational this weekend.
On Friday, November 18th, the Rowan D2 ice hockey team traveled north to play Montclair State University. The first period had no scoring. However, the profs came out guns blazing in the second, scoring 5 goals, all unanswered. The profs went on to win 6-0 with 5 different players scoring goals in the process.
On Saturday, November 19th, the Rowan D2 profs took on the Westchester Golden Rams at home. No goals were scored in the first period. Rowan then opened up scoring when Alec Nikolai assisted Mike McGahey at 5 minutes and 46 seconds. Sam Meyer added a goal before the first ended as well. Westchester answered in the third period with 3 unanswered goals. Zach Glanding scored the equalizer at 10:32. No goals were scored in the overtime period and the game went into a shootout. Matt Morelli played hero as he got the game-winning shootout goal. Rowan goes on to face Ryder and Wagner this upcoming weekend.
And that does it for us. We thank you for joining us for this episode of All Access. For Lenny Schnee, Kevin Cornell, Thomas DiNapoli, Cody Decker, and the entire All Access team, I'm Nolan Foy, and we will see you next time.
Thanks for having me, Wagner.
Certainly not a place you are unfamiliar with.
Sorry.
It's the latest on Division II ice hockey team. I tried.
Prompost? No, you gotta get in front of me. You gotta prompost.
Yeah, that probably did not work out too well.
Two is me! I'm looking at the floor. That's three, thank you.
I thought I was a super.